Assalamu alaikum and good afternoon. Thanks for inviting me. I've been asked to cover the whole of the Hodgkin lymphoma in 30 minutes, so I'll try to do that. Hopefully, we'll try to cover as much as be possible. So Hodgkin lymphoma, progress and prospects. I have nothing to disclose. First, we will discuss about the early stage Hodgkin lymphoma. And we all are aware that where the Hodgkin lymphoma treatment is coming from, it started from the wide portal field, mental field radiotherapy to the combined modality treatment in the last two decades, which has been a completely standardized treatment. And if we see the multiple trials which has been done in this setting, all are giving the response rate and the survival rate significantly up to the 94%. So combined modality treatment up till about a few years ago been standard treatment giving a complete chance of cure. But since now that we know that the data regarding the PET scan is barging in and everybody is discussing about the PET scan and the results of the PET scan, whether it can change the treatment or not. So it has completely changed the whole treatment scenario. Now what we do is, in this highly curative treatment group, we are talking about how to treat the patient to decrease the long-term risk and long-term side effects, which you find it in the patient who received radiotherapy. So in early Hodgkin lymphoma, nowadays what we are talking about is maximize the cure, but minimize the toxicity. And it's very important to maintain the balance. So what are the questions that we have and that has been tried to answer in the last 2-3 years? That do the all patients with early disease benefit from radiotherapy or not? Because can we tailor the treatment based on the PET scan? Does the all patient requires radiotherapy? Does the one size fits for all? Second question is, should the patient with early disease and positive interim PET scan be treated differently from those with a negative PET scan? Then it will keep on rising the questions. Then we will discuss about the role of brentuximab vedotin in early stage Hodgkin lymphoma. So these are the number of trials which have been reported in the last 1 year. I'm only talking about the phase 3 trials. I will just have a bit of a touch on the phase 2 trials, but these are the phase 3 trials which have been done. This is a rapid trial, and this is a EORT trial which we'll discuss in detail, and this is a German group trial which has not been reported at the moment. So let's talk about the rapid trial, the famous rapid trial which everybody talks about. So what they have done is, it's a UK trial and quite a significant decent amount of patients. They give AVVD 3 cycles, and if there is a PET negative, they randomize to radiotherapy versus no radiotherapy. And if it is PET positive, 1 cycle of extra chemotherapy and radiation. Just be sure that this rapid trial was only done as early stage Hodgkin lymphoma favorable type. So patient had no risk features at all. So fairly clean group actually. So that was a trial which is a PET, which is discussing about the PET based treatment. And what we have is if we see the progression-free survival in the PET negative group randomized to radiotherapy is 94%, with the PET negative group randomized to no further treatment is 90.8%. So about 4 months, 4%, 3.8 to 4% difference. If we talk about PET positive trial, PET positive arm, which received 1 shot of extra chemotherapy, has a 3 years progression-free survival of 86%. Overall survival is slightly less in PET positive arm, rest is almost the same. Just we need to make sure that this trial was a non-inferiority trial in which 7% margin was in place to determine whether it's non-inferior or inferior. Like if it is a 3.8% different, it means that both treatments are equal, they are non-inferior. Why they picked up the 7% figure? It's a matter to be debated. But actually that trial suggested, that trial designers have a concept in the mind that combined modality treatment does decrease the chance of cure about 5 to 6%. That put a margin of 7% and analyze it. And they graded it, these are the combined, if you skip the radiotherapy, is almost similar to the combined modality treatment. Let's talk about another trial, EORTC trial, which was combined with Lymphoma Study Association and the Italian group. What they did is they gave two cycles of ABVD. They did again a PET scan after two cycles. Then they gave extra cycle of ABVD and radiotherapy. That was the standard treatment regime that they followed. Then this was a trial arm. They did a PET scan. If it is PET negative, extra two cycles and omission of radiotherapy. If it is PET positive, what they have done is they have escalated ABVD to BCOP, which was entirely a different concept they have floated. Same concept was applied in unfavorable with extra doses, extra cycles of chemotherapy. Again, the idea behind was, the primary objective of this trial was whether can we safely omit the radiotherapy in the PET negative arm or not. And secondary objective was, can we escalate to BCOP or not? Now, when the trial completed 1 year of accrual, they did a pre-planned interim analysis, and they found that patients who skipped the radiotherapy have a progression-free survival of 94% versus a patient who had a radiotherapy have a progression-free survival of 100%. So there is a 6% difference. This was a non-inferiority. This was not a non-inferiority trial, so they stopped the recruitment in this arm, and they closed this primary objective arm, and they continue recruiting the patient to fulfill the secondary objective. Now you can argue that rapid trial has a difference of 4%. They said our trial is successful. EORTC is saying our progression-free survival is 6% different, and they stopped the trial. So this is a statement which you can argue about, but at least it gives an idea that combined modality treatment gives you a survival benefit of about 5 to 6%. And if you don't combine it with the radiotherapy, you lose about 5 to 6% benefit. Now come to the secondary objective of this trial, the SD10, same ERTC SD10, PET positive. And then what they did is they analyzed it and they found that when they escalated the treatment, not only they improved the progression-free survival, but marginal improvement in overall survival. But because of the statistical evidence, because it was p-value was 0.06, so it was rejected. So it was clear, according to this trial, that they can increase the progression-free survival if they escalate the treatment from ABVD to BCOP in early stage disease. But nothing comes as a free ride, you know. This BCOP can cause a lot of toxicities, as everybody knows. So what you are achieving is getting a progression-free survival with some cost. So I would like to take a one step backward and see what has been happening. Like, if you compare the SD10 and SD11 trial versus the SD6 trial, NCIC, which has been very famous, which has been widely criticized of using a wide field radiotherapy field, old techniques, trial was done ages ago. But this is the only trial which we can compare with in, if we want to compare a radiotherapy-free treatment versus combined modality treatment. In this trial, SD6 trial, just to remind, they were all unfavorable disease. And what they have found, that if they receive only chemotherapy, no radiotherapy, the progression-free survival, you can see, is low as compared to the combined modality treatment that we found in the German Hodgkin's group, 87%, 93%, 86% versus 89%. But overall survival is almost equal rather than better, only 10 events. So this trial does suggest that radiotherapy can cause a lot of serious toxicities in the long run. This was a 10-year follow-up. And what they found, the patients are dying with the, not only because of the cancer, they are dying because of the late toxicities of the radiation, like secondary cancers. So this has completely changed the concept. Like, progression-free survival improvement, does that mean that it will increase the overall survival? That really need to be debated. Now, how can the brentuximab stay away from the early stage disease as well? As we all know, brentuximab is climbing up the stairs in terms of a management of Hodgkin lymphoma. So this was a trial done phase two setting by Dr. Craig Morsworth's group, and it is just a phase two interim analysis, but I want to show just a important feature regarding the results. So what they have done is brentuximab vedotin combined with AVD chemotherapy, PET scan after cycle two, and then continue with the brentuximab AVD chemotherapy. If it is PET negative, go for radiotherapy. PET positive, do the biopsy. Negative, go for radiation. Although it's 30 patient data, it's a small follow-up, it's a phase two data. But one thing which is the most important feature that is striking straight away, that they are attaining the PET scan negativity of 90%. If you see the REP trial, if you see the EORTC trial, which I've discussed it just now, you will not find this high rate of CR. You will find it in a range of about 75 to 80%. So what they are suggesting is that if we add a brentuximab vedotin, that you will achieve a high rate of PET CR if you do the PET scan after cycle two. And which further 92% when it reached the cycle four. So based on this, they have recruited 30 more patients, and hopefully by the end of same time next year, we'll have a more mature data. So conclusion. What I personally believe that prognosis of early stage Hodgkin lymphoma, since it's very good, and results of S10 and rapid trial are not different. What they are suggesting, what the results are shouting at you, that now 19-year-old girl should be treated differently than the 45-year-old man. You need to individualize the treatment based on the PET scan and discuss the options in front of the patient, like you do it in the breast cancer or in the colorectal cancer. These are the benefits, these are the risks. If you want to take the 5% risk, the patient takes it. If the patient says, no, I don't want to take any risk, they go for combined modality treatment. So I think this is a time, now we have reached to the stage that we should offer the treatment based on the case-by-case basis. And PET scan is guiding us in individualized treatment. The argument which radiation oncologists put in front of you that we are based on our argument on the side effects of the radiotherapy techniques which used to be used about 10 years ago. But new techniques have been developed. So what we can say is that in about next 10, 15 years, we'll have the results of the technique which we are using now. So there is a bit of a gray area that we are prescribing combined modality treatment without actually knowing the risk. What we think it might be not as much as it was used to be thought of. But again, this is a gray area. So PET scan, I personally believe, it's helping us in deciding the treatment on a case-by-case basis. Let's come towards the advanced stage disease in Hodgkin lymphoma. Here, the balance shifts towards maximizing the cure. As we know that about cure rate of Hodgkin lymphoma advanced disease is about 60 to 70% on maximum. So you want to attain the maximum chance of cure. At times, you compromise the toxicity. So balance is slightly tilt towards the maximizing the cure side. Again, the PET scan is playing the very important role. We know large data prospectively, retrospectively has suggested clearly that a PET scan after two cycles of chemotherapy is a very strong predictor and a very strong prognostic tool to decide about the patient's outcome. So what are the issues we are dealing with in Hodgkin lymphoma? Should all the patients receive more aggressive initial therapy, like old discussion, ABVD, BCOP, 5% benefit versus no side effects? This discussion, I don't think so we can settle it. Other question, should we treat the patient based on the PET scan? Like if the PET scan is negative, should we de-escalate the treatment? If the PET scan is positive, should we escalate the treatment? The other question is, should the treatment start from the beginning, start as an intensified course, and you decide based on the PET scan? Where is the brentuximab vedotin is sitting? What is the role of radiation in the patient of advanced disease, which has got the bulky disease? We all know our knee-jerk reflexes is, as soon as the patient we see advanced stage disease, we finish the chemotherapy and radiate the bulky site. But is it really true now? So there are five trials being done. I will discuss four, because the German trial is not reported yet. response adjusted therapy for Hodgkin lymphoma, very famous RATHEL study, everybody is talking about this trial, is that they start the treatment with ABVD, and after two cycles, there are two randomized arms, PET2 positive versus PET2 negative. The thing which I like about this trial is they float the concept that we can de-escalate the treatment of ABVD. If you see in the PET2 negative arm, if it is PET2 negative, they are randomized into ABVD versus AVD. So they get a bleomycin in first two cycle, and they get a bleomycin omitted if it is PET2 negative. So first time, and this is the only trial which addressed the issue of de-escalation of ABVD even. On the other arm, what they have done is escalate the PET2, escalate the treatment in terms if it is a PET2 positive to the escalated BCOP. And if it is persistent F2, then either go for salvage radiotherapy or consolidation radiotherapy. Though the thing which you can argue about this trial is that what's the normal practice is, most of the European centers and North American centers are doing is six cycles of ABVD. Where is the standard arm sitting there? So you can argue that there is no standard arm actually. But what they are saying is that if you are treating the patient based on the PET2 scan, we have enough data that if the PET2 scan is positive in the ABVD regime, like Professor Galimini's, Professor Zanzani's data, they are pretty much convinced that progression-free survival is about 40%. So the patient do so unwell that you don't put the patient in the randomized arm. Well, it's a topic we can discuss it. So the good thing about this trial is if you treat the patient on the PET2 basis and you are a fond of ABVD like most of us are, you can de-escalate the bleomycin very safely. Progression-free survival and overall survival are equal in ABVD versus AVD arm, which is, to be very honest, it's a lot calming actually. You can omit the bleomycin safely. As far as the escalated BCOP is concerned, you can see the progression-free survival has increased to 68%, overall survival to 86%. There's no standard arm, but they compare it with the historic data, which is around about 25 to 40%. So what this data is suggesting that you can escalate the treatment to the BCOP if the PET2 is positive. Let's see AHL 2011 data. This is a lymphoma study association group. What they started is, they started with a different concept. They didn't start with the ABVD, they start with the BCOP. And what they have done is, BCOP standard arm, this trial includes the standard arm actually. Six cycles of BCOP, doesn't matter what the PET scan is. That is the normal practice. And an experimental arm, BCOP two cycles, positive and negativity. If it is negative, de-escalate to ABVD. If you see the results, although it is an interim analysis, it's only 2-year survival data that we have, but actually it is not bad. If the patient who is having a PET scan, 2-year progression survival based on the PET scan basis, 73% PET positivity versus 93% PET negative. And if you compare it with the ABVD with the BCOP, it's the same. So what they are suggesting, if you start with the two cycles of BCOP, you can safely de-escalate to ABVD. Both are having the same survival, 94 or 92%. But if it is a PET2 positive, you should carry on with the BCOP. It's give you a survival benefit of about 75% and 71%. There are two more trials which I'm not going to go in detail. Both are Italian group study. And what we have seen is, following the same concept, starting with the ABVD and getting almost the same result. But this also phase two data, interim analysis. Professor Zanzani has gone one step further. He's sitting next door, actually. I was discussing with him. What he has done is ABD2, and if it is PET2 positive, switch the gear and go for salvage chemotherapy and transplant them. This is actually a very aggressive approach. And I found it very impressive. And I spoke to him, and he's doing it in normal practice. What actually he's saying that you can achieve the progression-free survival of 75%. But the cases are very small in numbers, and it's only 2-year data. So that's what the escalation and de-escalation treatment. Now, where we are standing in terms of a de-escalation treatment of a radiotherapy. We all know what we do is we give 6 cycles of AVVD in advanced cases, bulky disease, and radiate the bulky site. And SD15, German study, which they give a BCOP, and they found bulky disease is not a prognostic value if it is PET scan negative. And according to SD15 trial, you can omit the radiation to the bulky site if the patient achieves a PET CR. But that was in the BCOP setting. So we don't have any evidence for the ABVD setting. What we have, British Cancer Columbia Agency have done, they have done their retrospective data analysis and case record analysis. And what they usually follow is they give 6 cycles of ABVD and they do the end scan and treatment CT scan. If CT scan is CR, it's fine. If the CT scan is showing a residual disease of more than 2.5 centimeter, they do the PET scan. If the PET scan is negative, they don't radiate the patient. And what they have found is that if the PET scan is negative and if it is a bulky disease, 5-year treatment-free is 89%, which is almost similar to the PET negative non-bulky disease. So what they are suggesting is that it is a lot better to omit the radiation treatment even in the ABVD, if you are following the ABVD protocol. Now let's talk about the brentuximab vedotin. We all know this is an old study published in 2013 by Dr. Yunus. We all know that if you combine brentuximab with ABVD, it causes a horrendous pulmonary toxicity. But this trial is recruiting, which we call Echelon study, brentuximab with the afferent use of ABD versus 6 cycles of ABVD. And later on this year, hopefully, they will present their data in ASH. And that is a very interesting study, I think. Because the issue is that whatever we have discussed it now will go into the vein because brentuximab might be the first treatment of choice. Now coming towards the relapse refractory setting, what do we have? We know we can optimize the treatment in 3 settings in a relapse and refractory group. Either we increase the response rate prior to the high-dose chemotherapy and transplant, either we can give something extra in the conditioning regime, or either we give them something maintenance after the transplant. We'll discuss about the scenario 3 first. Famous study, ATHERA study, we all know, Dr. Craig Moskowitz's group has recruited high-risk group in his cohort. After the salvage treatment, they get a transplant, and the patient who either refracted to front line or relapsed in less than 12 months or relapsed greater than 12 months with extranodal disease received the brentuximab vedotin as a maintenance versus placebo. Most of us know about the data. He published it in 2014. That was a 2-year survival data. But now, in 2015, he has published the 3-year survival data. And we have seen the brentuximab vedotin has improved the progression-free survival enormously with a hazard ratio of 0.52. So almost doubling the progression-free survival if you give the brentuximab vedotin as a maintenance with no extra side effects. Brentuximab vedotin as a first salvage. This is actually the study which Dr. Craig Moskowitz is doing, and what he's of the view that according to his cohort of group of the patient, he can salvage the patient without giving chemotherapy. That was an amazing concept. What he did, he gave it two cycles of weekly brentuximab vedotin, that is week 1, week 2, week 3, week 4 was a break, then again week 5, week 6, week 7, and week 8 was a break. PET scan negative, go for transplant. PET scan positive, go for salvage ICE, and if it is negative, go for the transplant. In that group, what he has achieved is, he achieved the same sort of a CR rate on the PET basis, pre-transplant, but he has rescued 27% of the patient without having any chemotherapy. This survival, what he reported survival was just 20-month survival rate. It's not huge. And I think once the data will be more mature, we'll be able to comment on this in more detail. But event-free survival was 80% for the patient who was PET negative. So it is an impressive data, actually, to be very honest. Brentuximab vedotin. Everybody knows about this trial. This is a pivotal study by Dr. Yunus, published ages ago, about 3 years ago, using brentuximab vedotin in relapsed refractory setting. Last ASH 2015, they reported a 5-year survival data, and what we have found is still the same. As you all know, the 2-year survival data showing an overall response rate of 75% and a complete response rate of about 34%, and is still getting the same. Overall survival of 40 months and progression survival of 9.3 months median. The interesting thing which I found in this study, what he did is he assessed the survival group based on the response. And you can see the patients who achieved the CR are not crossing the median as well. So more than 50% patients are still surviving 5 years later if they achieve the CR. So technically they are cured actually. Same for the overall survival. The median is not reached even. PD-1 checkpoint inhibitors. We all know the data. This data is coming up. Hodgkin lymphoma express a huge amount of PD-L1 receptors, and nivolumab has been used in the phase 1 setting. In ASH 2014, the data was presented and created a big news. What has been reported in the last ASH 2015 was extended follow-up data, and we have seen that 22% were in the CR, 5 patients were able to go for the stem cell transplant, and they remained in CR for 1.5 years after the treatment was initiated. Same result they got it for the pembrolizumab as well, almost. So 87% survival with nivolumab, 87% overall response with nivolumab, with 26% CR, and 65% for pembrolizumab, 16% CR. It's a phase 1 data, but it gained the breakthrough status from the FDA. And what now they are doing is, as we were just speaking to Professor Zindani, they are using nivolumab in brentuximab vedotin combination in a various setting of Hodgkin's lymphoma. So what are the key issues now in terms of advanced and the relapsed refractory setting? If ECHELON trial is positive, what will happen? It will change the entire scenario. Should all the patients with advanced stage Hodgkin lymphoma with brentuximab AVD for 6 cycle, if the trial is positive, should we use it? I think it's a very costly treatment, but you can argue it all depends upon the cost. Does almost doubling in 3-year progression-free survival indicate that all patients should receive post-transplant brentuximab vedotin maintenance? Probably, again, depend upon the cost. Should all patients with Hodgkin lymphoma have a PET-2 as a part of the management? I think absolutely yes. We should do the PET-2 scans in the advanced stage setting, provided if we have a capacity that is going to be reported in a standardized manner. What will happen if the checkpoint inhibitors are approved? Where are they going to sit? Will you going to use it? I think the survival which you are getting, the response rate which you are getting is almost more than the brentuximab even. So I'm pretty much sure if that's going to be approved, we should use it. Thank you.